Welcome to GADEPS. Today, Salomon Rebollo Perdomo is going to talk about abelian integrals for trivial global monodromy polynomials. Okay, Salomon.
Okay, thank you. First of all, would like to thank Hussein for the invitation and all of you to be here. Well, this is a recent work. It's a young work with Jesús Mosiño Raimundo at CCM UNAM, Mexico. This is an unpublished result yet, but I think it's a good option to present here some ideas. Well, let me start with the result, what I want to prove, or at least the area of the proof. This is the main result that says that we can know some nice properties of abelian integrals for some kind of special polynomials. I want to explain, of course, all the ingredients of this result in a moment. But in order to have in mind what kind of result we are talking about. Well, let me start with some motivation for this problem about abelian integrals. And after, I will start with the areas of the proof of this result. I will recall it later. Okay. So the motivation is very, in some sense, very simple. We can think in a real polynomial in two variables of some degree with a minimum at the origin, okay? So the level curves of this polynomial can look like with some of this picture. A level curve can have many connected components, but with this restriction or with this condition of a minimum at the origin, we assert that we can have a closed curves around the origin. This closed curves we call cycles or loops. So in this, according to this picture, we have a cycle for all the parameters C from zero, where from values positive values, up to a concrete value C hat. Okay, so this all these cycles form a continuous family. This is one of the ingredients of the problem. The other ingredient is to think about one differential form, one polynomial differential forms in the plane. And we fix, for example, the degree. The degree of the one form is the maximum of the degrees of the coefficients of this polynomial one form. So with these two ingredients, we can think in two different scenarios. We can address a problem in a dynamic approach and other problem with an analytic approach. In the first case, we can think in a differential equation form with the Hamiltonian given by the polynomial and a perturbation in the direction of the polynomial one form that we have chosen. And this is called an infinitesimal perturbed Hamiltonian differential equation. And in the analytic approach, we can think in this function I that maps every value of C into the integral of the one form along the cycles of our Hamiltonian H. And this is called an abelian integral that we means the integral of a rational, in general, a rational one form along loops or cycles of algebraic curves. In this case, a real algebraic curves. But these two problems belong to different worlds, but they are connected in some sense. The infinitesimal differential equation can have medium amplitude limit cycles. This is one of the motivation for study this kind of differential equations. In the other hand, our function I have can have isolated zeros, and these two objects are almost related. It's not a correspondence, but they are related. I will explain how these two objects are related. But of course, by an isolated zero, we understand as isolated zero in the classical sense of a function. But let me explain a little bit the concept of median amplitude limit cycles. Well, the infinitesimal perturbation of the Hamiltonian is interesting, and this is an idea that goes back to Poincaré, who shows that the perturbed Hamiltonian equation in general can have limit cycles, but these limit cycles bifurcate from the unperturbed differential equations. In this case, we have assumed that for epsilon equal to zero, we have only the Hamiltonian, and the solutions are the level curves that we have showed in the previous pictures. So we have a continuous family of cycles. For epsilon different from zero, the question is how the solution of the differential equation looks like. In other words, can we describe the phase portrait? Well, we can have isolated periodic orbits. These are called limit cycles, in the sense that in a neighborhood of this periodic orbit, we can have other periodic orbits. So the neighboring solutions approach asymptotically to this periodic orbit. And these limit cycles can bifurcate from one of the cycles of the unperturbed system. In this case, we call this limit cycle for epsilon different from zero a medium limit cycle. Of course, the perturbed equation can have limit cycles which are not medium limit cycles, in the sense that they don't bifurcate from the Hamiltonian. On the other hand, with respect to our function I, this is a real analytic function, but some question appears. This function is polynomial. This question is quite natural because it's defined by two polynomial objects. So maybe this function remains polynomial, but it's only a question. If not, so the question is at least rational? How many zeros does this function have? Well, these two problems or these two scenarios have two important problems I just mentioned here. In the first case, related with the Hamiltonian perturbed Hamiltonian differential equations, we have the infinitesimal Hilbert 16 problem, which asks about to find an upper bound for the number of medium amplitude limit cycles, just for the medium amplitude limit cycles. With respect to the analytic function, we have one of the Arnold's favorite problems that we call the weak infinitesimal Hilbert 16 problem, which consists of to find an upper bound for the number of isolated zeros of this abelian integral. Now let me explain how this the median amplitude limit cycles at the zeros are related. These two objects are related to the displacement function. Yes, I recall it briefly. We can think in a perturbed Hamiltonian differential equation, and we assume that the unperturbed, the Hamiltonian equation, has a family of cycles, as we show in the first picture. So the question is how we can control the median limit cycles. The limit cycles of the perturbed system can be controlled through the displacement function which this function is defined through the difference of the initial and final point of a solution in a transversal section that we can choose for our problem. So the blue curve here represents the one of the cycles of the unperturbed system, and the red one is the solution of the perturbed system. Of course, I don't mention, but the epsilon is a small parameter. So for epsilon small, the solution of the perturbed system remains close to the blue one. This implies that in a transversal section, we can have well-defined the field return map. This is which I represent by this P epsilon C. And this difference is called the displacement function. Of course, if this difference is zero, it means that the red one curve is closed, a periodic orbit. In addition, if this displacement function have isolated zeros, we have limit cycles because such periodic orbits are isolated. Okay, so this displacement function can be measured by the difference, of course, of the initial and final point in this sense, but we can measure also by taking into account the Hamiltonian function H and evaluate the function in the initial and final point. In this sense, we have only two variables, epsilon and C, because the points P and Q are two. So in order to have a well-defined function in two variables, we take this condition. Well, so this displacement function can be expressed in this way, and by the fundamental calculus theorem, we can express through this integral. On the other hand, the field return map of analytical function is also an analytical function. Therefore, since the displacement function is the difference of two analytical functions, we have a power series for this function. If we integrate the perturbed Hamiltonian differential equations along its solutions, then we have zero, because this gamma epsilon C is a solution, and by linearity we have this one. On the other hand, the first term, this integral, is the displacement function, which then we can replace this integral by this analytic, this power series, and reordering terms we express in this way. Now we can divide by epsilon and take the limit when epsilon goes to zero, and we obtain that this L1 function is exactly the integral of the one form along the cycle, the blue cycle, because the red one, as epsilon goes to zero, the red one goes to the blue one. But this is precisely the function, the abelian integral function that we defined previously. Okay, so, and the relation with the medium limpid cycles and the isolated zeros is given by this criterion that is called the Poincaré-Pontryagin-Andronov criterion, that says that the number of medium amplitude limit cycles of the perturbed Hamiltonian differential equation is bounded by the isolated zeros of the first term in the displacement function that does not vanish. In particular, if k is to 1, is 1, we have the abelian integral that we defined previously. Another important fact is that for almost almost polynomial one force omega, this integral does not vanish. Therefore, the abelian integrals controls the medium amplitude limit cycles. And if we solve the weak infinitesimal Hilbert Cissé problem for with k equals to 1, so we can control or bound the number of medium limit cycles. But there are perturbed systems which can have medium limit cycles even when the abelian integral vanishes identically. This is one of the consequences that the medium limit cycles and isolated limit zeros, are not exactly a correspondence. Well, so this criterion is the connection, the bridge between the differential equations board and the complex, the analytic functions work. But of course, well, I concentrate mostly in the weak infinitesimal Hilbert system problem. This is, I mean, about the abelian integrals. But the study of abelian integrals have some difficulties, but there are some interesting ideas, and I present just two general results. Of course, there are many important results, but I just mentioned two. Concerning the difficulties in the real case is that the abelian integral is unknown in general, and this is because the cycles can be parametrized explicitly, so we can't compute it, these abelian integrals. On the other hand, the Hamiltonian, the polynomial H, can have many families of cycles. So we can have many abelian integrals for just one polynomial. How to manage these difficulties? Well, there are some areas. The first is maybe classical and goes to back to Abel, that says complexify to simplify. This means that the abelian integral is very understood on C that instead of the reals. Other important idea is given by Ilyashenko, that says that each real limit cycle is a complex limit cycle. Therefore, These two ideas suggest to complexify our polynomial and our word form. And the general results about abelian integrals, the first one goes to 90s, the 1940, the previous century, and was given independently by Kovansky and Barchenko, that says that the upper bound for the number of zeros is finite. The more recent result is given by Benjamini, Novikov, and Yakovenko 2 years late before, well, more almost 10 years, that and they give an explicit upper bound for the number of zeros as a double exponential in the m and n. Recall that m represents m plus 1 is the degree of the Hamiltonian h of the polynomial h, and n is the degree of the one form. But this upper bound is not optimal for small degrees. So appears the question how to get accurate upper bounds, at least for small degrees. Well, this is one of the ideas that we use in this work. We impose some simplifications in the Hamiltonian in this case in order to get accurate upper bounds. Okay, now how to if we have to complexify, the first question is how what the complexifications means. Well, this means only to consider the variables h and y complex variables instead of real variables. The coefficients of the Hamiltonian can be remain reals or complex in general, but if originally we have a real polynomial, then its complexification is just to think in the variables as complex variables. And the first question is how looks like the level curve in the complex plane? Well, I will give us an idea of this question, or the answer of this question. So we think in the plane, in the complex plane, and we fix the complex line for the first variable a x. Okay. So our polynomial h can be represented as a polynomial in the variable y whose coefficients are polynomials in the variable x. This area allows to see this fact. For almost every point in the complex, I mean Cx, we obtain a polynomial in the variable y. Fix it the x, then we have a complex polynomial in the variable y with complex coefficients, of course, and then this polynomial or this equation have the different solution. D is the degree of the polynomial in this case. Then in the picture, we see for a fixed point, then we have here this n must be a d or vice versa. Sorry. Okay, we have d or n different solution for this equation. This means d roots for this. This equation. Then, if we move this original point in the base, then The roots also moves, describing sets which are topologically a disk. But if we move away from this point x0, then the roots can be collide. This means at this point we have we lost the difference of the different solutions, and we have d minus one in this picture. In of course we can have less of the solutions, and when this phenomenon happen, we have a ramification point. So with this area, we can say that the level curve can be seen as the copies of the complex line with some marked points which have to be identified. These red points are the ramification points. Therefore, they have to identify. How to identify this? Well, the idea is to think the complex line as the Riemann sphere with the infinite delayed, and now apply this topological area. We join two points along a line and cut this sphere along this line, as the picture shows, and then apply topology, deform topologically these spheres in order to glue these red points. And finally, we obtain the level curve. In this case, the picture shows that the level curve is topologically a torus with three points removed. In general, the topology of a level curve of a polynomial in C2 is a Riemann surface of subgenus with some points removed, a compact Riemann surface with some points removed, the points at infinity. Well, now, so how we see the original problem in the complex? Well, as analogously to the real case, we consider a polynomial in the complex plane. So there is a finite set I call BH here, a finite set, in such a way that for any other point in the complement of this finite set, the level curve is a Riemann surface for all points in this complement, and all the level curves looks like the same topologically. But moreover, these points are, of course, the points at infinity, which have to be removed of this compact surface. Moreover, it is well known that if we restrict the polynomial to the pre-image or the complement, sorry, the complement to the pre-image of this finite set, then this function is say infinity locally trivial federation. This means that for every point in the complement of this finite set, we can find a small enough disk around any point, in such a way that the pre-image of this disk can be rectified, in the sense that is the same infinity diffeomorphically a product of the disk with just one of these surfaces. This property allows to move the elements of one surface to another. In particular, if we choose a cycle, a complex cycle, that I mean a loop whose homological class is non-trivial in the surface. And since these three surfaces in the picture are diffeomorphically equivalent by this property, then this blue curve can be moved to the neighboring fibers. So very natural, we obtain continuous family of cycles, as we have in the real case by imposing the minimum. But here we can impose almost anything, just for any polynomial with degree at least two, we have this property of continuous families of cycles. And the on the other hand, the complexification of the one form is very simple. It's a one form, but now the coefficients are complex polynomials. And the degree, of course, is again the degree, the maximum of the degrees of the coefficients. And here in the complex world, we have also the two problems, as in the reals, the dynamic and the analytic approach, the infinitesimal perturbed Hamiltonian differential equation and the Abelian integral. But now we have a complex differential equation whose solutions are now Riemann surfaces, and the Abelian integral now is a function of a small disk of in the complex to another to the complex numbers by integrating the one form along these cycles. And we have analogously the median amplitude limit cycles and the isolated zeros of this now complex function. In this case, the median limit cycles is a little different. Now here in the complex case, we have a cycle. We recall that this means a loop whose homological class is non-trivial. So we can think in a piece of the surface, a small space, a piece of the surface, and this cycle can persist after the perturbation, and the neighboring cycles break down. So we have here a topological cylinder whose leaves are asymptotically, approach asymptotically to this topological cylinder. And this is, I call a medium complex limit cycle. Concerning the Abelian integral in this in the complex, this function is locally holomorphic. This means is holomorphic in this small disk delta that we showed previously here. This is a holomorphic function, but the question is: this function is entire, is polynomial. How many zeros does this function have? Analogously to the real case, but now with complex structures, in particular the integer property. And of course, we have also here the questions. Is true, I put here as a question, is true that the median limit cycle is finite? I put in this way because we know that there are polynomial differential equations with infinitely many limit cycles. So I don't have the answer to this question. Maybe it's finite or maybe no, I don't know. Concerning the Abelian integral, is the same problem to find the upper bound. I recall that the Barchenko-Kovansky theorem says that this upper bound is finite. Okay, and the Yakovenko-Benjamini-Novikov result gives an explicit upper bound.
Salomon, you have to fix a region in this, in the complex domain, in the C domain, because you can make a monodromy and produce more zeros.
Yes, exactly. I ghost there.
Okay.
Yes. So the as in the reals, also we have in the complex some difficulties remains. And the main difficulties I think are the following when we consider an abelian integral. That I present here, this every abelian integral has two main ingredients, the one form and the continuous family of cycles. And with these two objects, we construct this function. But we can find here three difficulties, an analytic difficulty, an algebraic difficulty, and an topological or geometrical difficulty. In the analytical difficulty, I think in the cycles. The main difficulty is that these cycles can't be parametrized. So these abelian integrals, in general, can be computed explicitly. Regarding the algebraic difficulty, is in the space of the one forms. In principle, this omega belongs to a finite vectorial space, but of course there are infinitely many one forms. So if we want to fix only the degree, we have to simplify this vectorial space in some sense in order to have few abelian integrals to study. And this difficulty can be in most of the cases solved by studying the relative cohomology. That means essentially to reduce the vectorial space in a small vectorial space. But I think the main difficulty globally is the topological one, and this is related intrinsically in the function. And this is precisely the monodromy that Hossein mentioned previously.
And maybe just the notion of to be parameterized is not well defined. Of course, you cannot parameterize by sinus and cosinus function, but maybe there are other strange functions that you can parameterize it. So I don't know. What has to first define what it means to be parameterized?
Yes, when I think and we can parameterize is in terms of elementary functions.
Okay.
Yes. So in most of the cases, the abelian integrals are only studied alternative methods, no direct methods in the sense of computing these integrals. Well, let me explain this monodromy the phenomena, this global topological difficulty with the following picture. And we think in this point C0 in the base, so the level curve of in this point is a Riemann surface as we see, and fixed a cycle in the blue one. So this cycle can be transported to the neighboring fibers according to the law of trivial definition, and we can move, and we can arrive to the original surface, but the cycle arrives to other cycle. But this phenomenon occurs when we move in a loop that surround a special point. Recall that we mentioned previously that there is a finite set where in the complement all the surfaces looks like the same, but in this finite set the topology changes. These are called the critical or singular values of the polynomial, and when we move or cycle around a loop which contains in the interior one of these singular values, then the cycle arrives to another point. In this, this means that the abelian integral is not well-defined, because for the point C0, we have two cycles. So the function is not well-defined. And this is precisely the simplification that we make in this work by imposing that the monodromy is trivial. I'm going to explain this, but before I mentioned that as we have this phenomena that the surface after a transport come back to the same surface, we have an automorphism of the surface. For every loop in the base, we move the surface and we come back to the same. So we have defined a diffeomorphism. These diffeomorphisms can be restricted only to the homology. And this is called the monodromy operator of the loop. I explain here and resume some of the principal the concepts that I will use. The first is the theorem of René Thom that says, I mentioned previously, for each polynomial, there is a finite set such that this restriction is a infinity local trivial fibration. And the polynomial H is called primitive if for all the points in the complement of this finite set, the fiber, which is called the generic fiber, is connected. In other words, the polynomial is irreducible, or the algebraic curve is irreducible. Then we have the primitive property. Now, as we mentioned, for every loop in the base, and this means we can consider the fundamental group. So for every loop in the base, we have an automorphism of the homology of the surface. Then we have this homomorphism group. And the monodromy group of this polynomial H is the image of this homomorphism, the image in the group of automorphisms of the fiber, of the homological of the fiber. And we say that the polynomial has trivial global monodromy if this image is the identity map. If for every cycle we have always the identity map, this means that the cycle, I come back to the picture, this means when we move the cycle, we have to come back to the same because it's the identity. Okay, so this phenomena does not appear. And this is the simplification that we make in order to have the abelian integral well-defined, at least in the complement of this finite set. And so I come back to the main result. Maybe now it's better understand now. We consider a primitive polynomial with trivial global monodromy, a polynomial complex one form, So for every cycle in the fiber, the cycle can be moved, can be transported, and we obtain this family of cycles gamma I of C, and then we integrate this this one form. This function is well defined in this in C minus the finite set according to the Thom's theorem, but the additional information of this result is that this function extends holomorphically to the whole C. In addition, this extension is polynomial. Moreover, if we fix the degree of H and the one form, then we can control the degree of this polynomial function. Here appears three conditions, and we explain why. Sorry, can you say me how much time?
You have around 2, 7, 8 minutes.
Okay. Thank you. Well, in order to give the area of the proof, I need to definition. The first one is that two complex polynomials are algebraically equivalent if we can find two automorphisms, one of the plane and one of the C, in such a way that this diagram commutes. Here, the subscripts are important for the next explanations. The other one definition is that two complex one forms are algebraically equivalent if they are related to through this equation. Okay, so the idea is, if we have initially a polynomial H, maybe this polynomial has a degree high degree, but maybe we can find two automorphisms in such a way that the new polynomial has a small degree. But of course, since these are automorphisms, all the properties, topological and properties of H remains or persists for the new polynomial H-calligraph. If this degree is smaller than the original, maybe we can simplify in some sense the computations or the study of the abelian integrals. Of course, if we can find these two automorphisms, the original omega, the original one form, can be transformed in a new polynomial one form. So the abelian integral can be the abelian integral problem can be transformed by automorphisms of the plane and C. And the idea then is the following. So as we explained, the automorphisms group acts in the space of polynomials. And the hard result behind of assertion of theorem is a result of Newman and Norbury that essentially says the following. Each polynomial with trivial global monodromy has a normal form in the sense that this polynomial can be transformed in a new one by using two automorphisms, one of the plane and one of the C. And in addition, there is every normal form additionally has a can be rectified in the sense that this polynomial admits a birational transformation that transforms the generic fibers of the polynomial H into punctured horizontal lines. In particular, this says that the topology of the fibers of the original polynomial, this means trivial global monotony polynomials, the topology is essentially a sphere with some points dilated. Since the fibers are spheres, in the sphere, the parametrizations can be done, so the computations of the Abelian integrals can be realized. In addition, this is kind of conjugation through the automorphisms allows to transform the original problem, the original differential equation, in a new one, maybe with some simplifications in the degrees. And additionally, these differential equations can be rectified. Now, the Hamiltonian is topologically trivial, but the perturbation now is maybe a rational function. But integrate rational functions along curves in the sphere is easy. This is the idea. And finally, the idea of the proof is resumed in this diagram. We start with a polynomial H, a one form, omega. So the original problem and the Abelian integral related with this original problem can be transformed in a new one by using this algebraic equivalence. And additionally, in this case, can be transformed in a more simplified form by studying just a trivial perturbation of trivial foliations. So the computations of the idea of the proof of the related with the bounds, the explicit upper bounds, are here, because these Abelian integrals are in the spheres, essentially, so we can compute directly this upper bound. But now I have to mention the normal forms, because in other ways we can have this medium column. So this is the theorem of Neumann-Nürburgring, which says that every polynomial with trivial global monodromy can be transformed in one of these three families, which are explicitly. Okay. And there are three families. This gives origin to the three upper bounds that I mentioned in the theorem. Of course, if we consider just these polynomials, we can ask the problem of to find the upper bound for these polynomials, these concrete polynomials, and we obtain this result. For every polynomial in these families and every polynomial one form of some degree, here we distinguish with the original by this macfrac n, this macfrac m, and then we can find explicitly of the upper bounds for the number of the zeros of the Abelian integrals for these polynomials. And the idea of the proof, as we mentioned, is that we can rectify the foliation spheres into complex lines, is horizontal complex lines. Therefore, this birational transformation transforms the Abelian integral, which comes the original one, in a new one. But now this eta is a rational one form. But the advantage is that these alphas are in the sea. So this is as an integral as we study in the complex analysis course. And we can apply the residue theorem to compute explicitly these integrals. And moreover, since we know the parametrizations because we have explicitly the expression for the Hamiltonians, we can compute explicitly these integrals. Of course, this theorem is just for the families, but the theorem, as we show, is for general polynomial with trivial global monodromy, not just for these of the families. So the question is that if we can control the transformed objects. And the result that we prove is that yes, if we could start with a primitive polynomial, a general polynomial with trivial global monodromy of degree n plus 1, and a omega of degree n, then we apply the Neumann-Norbury classification, and we see which is the normal form for the original polynomial and how the omega is transformed. And here we can control the degrees of the transformed objects. The degree of the h can be is smaller than the original one. The degree of omega increase as the original one, but we can control for all the three families. Combining these two theorems, this one, the degree of the transformed objects and the upper bound for the families, combining these two results, we obtain the proof for our theorem. So this theorem solves the problem for all the polynomial with trivial global monodromy in the complex. And so a question is, what about the non-trivial case? Well, some with Marco Uribe the last year, I consider a polynomial with non-trivial global monodromy, and we were able to find upper bounds for the abelian integrals. But of course, here the computations of the abelian integrals is not possible directly, and in fact, these abelian integrals are not polynomial in general. And this is, I think, the most simple case for a rational, trivial global monodromy polynomial. Here are some references, the two papers of Neumann and Norbury, which are the hard result behind our theorem. And the last one of Marco and me, and other one from 2012, which is the first step in this direction. Here we concentrate in polynomials with a fiber C as a sphere minus 2 points, which is the simpler case for the trivial global monodromy in general. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Salomon, for this nice talk. Well, let me see if somebody has any question. Maybe I make a comment, Salomon, that I think the polynomiality in your theorem also follows from, after a little bit working, from the growth of periods near singularities. For example, in Arnold Gussain-Zadvarchenko's book, you can find this how the integrals behave near singularities. There is logarithmic function popping up, exponential popping up, and when once it is monodromy invariant, your IC. then it will be one valued, so one has to a little bit argue near the singularity. And
Yes, exactly. In fact, well, the abelian integral extends to this complement of this finite set. When we approach to this one of these singularities, the signs, in particular, since the topology are spheres, then the homological cycle remains bound. As we approach to the singular value, then the length of the abelian integral, or the norm of the abelian integral, is bounded by the norm of the one form times the length of the curve, since the norm of the one form is bounded and the length of the cycle also remains bounded. The singular theorem remove, how do you say? The Riemann theorem for singularity, remove singular theorem,
Exactly.
it says that in this point also is holomorphic. And after, so this idea allows to prove that the abelian integral extends to the whole C holomorphically, so we have an integer function. And after, we have to study a little bit how is the growth of this abelian integral as we go to infinity. And we
Exactly.
are able to prove that this growth is bounded polynomially. Then for an exercise of complex analysis that says that this is a property only for polynomial functions.
Okay, let me stop recording.